Hi, Mariners Church, and happy Labor Day weekend. I'm so excited that you're joining us today. If it's your first time at Mariners Online, we are so glad that you are here. We'd love to learn a little bit more about you and how we can serve or pray for you. Please take a moment and fill out the Connect card that can be found in the chat window or at marinerschurch.org/connect. Now, let's join in together as we worship.
reasons that we couldn't escape. But he came and he died and he rose. Those walls are rubble now.
My profession is an obstetrician-gynecologist. Before I met Christ, it was a business. Since then, it's a ministry. Before I met Christ, the way I did my profession was, it was all about me. I can guarantee you a perfect baby, and I will make you a perfect family. It was all about me. I think that the turning point and the pivotal point in my life where I said, I'm turning my life over to Jesus. It was the kindness he showed me while I was still a sinner. I was, every debauchery of lifestyle that I was, it was kind of like he showed that kindness even when I didn't know him. I was excited. I was electrified by my Lord, and I wanted to tell everybody. And it was more kind of like, this is what happened to me, the story about my changes. And then the whole office became a ministry. I would invite people to church. I would ask people about their faith, when things got tough, when people had a stillborn or miscarriage or infertility issues, I would say, let God help you. And for people who were of faith, I would pray and sit down and pray about what God was going to do, encourage him, give him hope, and know that God was going to do something wonderful beyond what I could do. God equips you to do the work he does. You see God's goodness in these dark places if you just lean into him. How do I translate that to my patient care? I've seen God in the situation you're in, and this is how he helped me. And I pray that you will lean into him and pray and know God during this time, and he shows up in a whole different way.
Are you, Lord?
It's a joy to worship with you today. My name is John, and I serve as the discipleship pastor. Your partnership in the gospel makes it possible for us to reach more and more people throughout Southern California and around the world with the good news of Jesus. Every weekend, we're serving tens of thousands of people through Mariners Online, in total reaching 3,100 U.S. cities, all 50 states, and across 130 different countries. And through our Mariners Hosted Here sites, we're reaching people unable to attend church regularly and bringing them together in life-giving community at assisted living facilities, mental health centers, residential youth programs, and more. Here are just a few of the places where God has opened the doors for us through Mariners Hosted Here. This is Bill, one of our Mariners Hosted Here hosts, leading a gathering he launched at his assisted living facility this year. These are some of the cadets of Sunburst Youth Academy, a program for at-risk youth, listening to the online message at their facility where we've been hosting chapel services for more than a year. And here's a picture of the leaders of one of our newest Mariners Hosted Here sites in Utah, where people from the same neighborhood are coming together to worship and grow together every weekend. We're hoping to launch even more of these Hosted Here locations in the coming year, and your generosity is what makes that possible. Each person who joins us online or through Mariners Hosted Here or at one of our seven congregations has the opportunity to go deeper into God's Word, to connect in community, and take courageous steps of faith. And your help to create these amazing environments through your giving is what makes this possible. Giving is an important spiritual discipline that shows that you understand grace and that you desire to grow even more in that grace. God has given everything that we have, and He graciously invites us to give as a part of a response of worship to what He is doing in the world. When we give of what He's blessed us with, we actively partner in building His kingdom. And our own faith grows as we learn to trust Him with everything that we have. If you'd like to give now, you can text the number below. Thank you for joining us and sharing the gospel with people all around the world. In just 2 weeks, we'll be launching Rooted across all of our congregations and online. It's a great opportunity for you to get connected in community as you learn more about God, the church, and your purpose. And for the first time, we have Rooted online groups by time zone with leaders who are ready and excited for you to join at any time. You can sign up for an in-person or online group now through the link below. Next weekend, we'll be launching a brand new series, Losing It, looking at anger's effects on our lives and seeing what the scripture says about our anger. I hope you'll join us and also invite others as we learn how God helps us overcome the grip of anger in our lives and find ultimate peace in Him. With many students back in school, I want to take a moment now and acknowledge and pray for all of our teachers. Teachers, we are so thankful for you, and the impact that you're making on the next generation is substantial. The way that you serve students and their families so well makes a huge difference in their lives and ultimately all of our lives as you faithfully serve our communities. And now I'd love to take a moment to pray a prayer of blessing over you for this school year. God, we are so thankful for these teachers. We're thankful that you have called them to the vocation of education. And we pray in this next year ahead that you would equip and empower them to live out their calling for your glory. Would you be their peace and would you be their portion? We ask this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Now let's join Kenton B. Shore as we finish our series exploring how we can make the most of our lives. You can access today's message notes using the Mariners app or through the link in the chat.
What is the first command given in the Bible? You might say it's to love God, but that's not the first command. That's what we call the greatest command. You could say to have no other gods before me. That's just the first command of the Ten Commandments. It's not the first command. You'd say to fear not. That's the most often repeated command in the Bible, but it is not chronologically the first command given in the Bible. So what is the first command given by God, chronologically speaking? It is to work. You go, work? Why would it be work? Now, when we talk about work, we're talking about how we all spend the majority of our time, whether it's in an office or in a building, a job site, at home, in a classroom, whether we're paid or we're volunteer. We understand what work is. And, you know, we have to ask the question, so why do we work? And so lots of us would answer that different ways. We might say, well, I work for money. I work for a sense of identity. It's who I am. You know, aren't we defined by what we do? You could say it's for significance, for recognition, that people can see what I do, or maybe a better tomorrow. But the question is, you know, so why do we work? What's amazing is that research is amazingly clear about this, that all of us basically work for one reason. They've done lots of research and they said what makes people happy at work. And it is not that your work is enjoyable. It isn't that you're paid enough. It's not because you get recognition or fame. And it's not even because you're achieving. It is, there's just one reason why we work. Research says this, and then we're going to see that God's word says it too. The reason that we work is because of the meaning that it brings. When we feel like we're making a valuable contribution, it defines how we view ourselves. And then it defines the work that we're doing. And even if we're doing a job we don't like, we can have joy in the work because it has meaning. So the conclusion is very powerful. We have to have a profound sense of meaning when it comes to work. So then the question is, well, how do we find meaning? And there's two avenues towards meaning. One is that we build it, we create it, and we try to construct it, invent it. And so it's within us. Or the second one is that we get it from the divine. We get it from God. And what research shows us is that when we try to invent it or construct it, it ultimately doesn't work. And so when we start and say, well, no, it's because if I get paid enough, if I can achieve enough, if there's enough recognition, or if I'm doing good, then ultimately, you know, by achieving it, I can find my meaning at work. But this idea of achievement ultimately destroys us. And this idea of trying to achieve something, research shows us that it destroys us, but also the Bible talks about how it destroys us. And Jennifer Wallace just wrote a new book called Never Enough. And the subtitle is When Achievement Culture Becomes Toxic. And it's amazing. She did all of this research with people from Harvard, and it's absolutely unbelievable what she discovered. So she said that when this toxic culture of achievement pressures kids or children, this is what it does to them. The destructive nature of the toxic culture of achievement is worse than being imprisoned as a child. It's worse than being brought up in the foster care system. It's worse than being a recent immigrant or growing up in poverty. It is that destructive. And it's hard to believe it's that destructive, but her research found that. And so she talks about it. And in her book, what she says, the solution, it all boils down to one idea, that if a child has meaning, if they understand that they matter, they bring value, it's not about what they achieve, but it's that they matter, it changes everything. And so in her conclusion, in her book, she says, I used to solve for my children the idea for happiness. I used to try to solve for happiness, but now I try to solve for meaning. So here's the good news. We're not left by ourselves when it comes to work to invent and construct the idea of meaning for our work. But God loves us so much that He actually gives meaning to our work. He tells us about it, and that what we get to do is we get to discover it. So today we're going to look at God's word, and we're going to discover how God brings meaning to our work. And maybe you've never heard it before, so you're going to love what God's word says. And maybe others of you have heard, you'll be reminded. But this is one of the reasons why we should love Jesus and want to follow Jesus, and we love God's word, because He teaches us and shows us that He gives us meaning to our work. So God, what we're going to see is that God cares about our work. And I think for most people, we think, well, we know that God cares about, you know, the lost and in salvation. He cares about the poor and doing good, but, you know, in church stuff. But does God really care about my work? And if God doesn't care about your work, which you spend most of your time doing, then does God really care about you? So we're in a series designed by Eric that I think he's done just a great job on, titled Making the Most of Your Life. He talked about making the most of your time, making the most of your gifts, making the most of your money, being generous. Last week, Doug talked about making the most of your relationships. And so today, what we're going to talk about is making the most of our careers or our work. And to do that, what we have to understand is that God gives meaning to our work. So we're going to understand four things that we get to. The way that God gives us meaning is that we share in God's management of creation through our work, that we get to share God's love to the world through our work. In our work, we get to experience God's generosity, and ultimately, we get to offer God's rest to the world through our work. So, first of all, in our work, we share in God's management of the world. When you begin, you know, we've all tried to read the book of we try to read the Bible. We start in Genesis. So we've all read the creation story, and it starts. And look at what it first reveals about God. God, the very first thing he reveals about himself is that he is a worker. Look at it in Genesis 1, verse 1 and verse 31. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and it goes along in that ellipsis, telling the whole story. He creates the heavens, the universe, the world, the oceans, the animals, and then he saw it was good. And he keeps creating, and he keeps saying it was good. And so what we see from the very beginning is that God is an artist. He is a creator. He is a worker. He combines astronomy, chemistry, biology, physics, botany, zoology. He is an architect. He is a landscape architect. He is a gardener. And God is working all for one purpose. And what is that? To serve us, to create a home for us, to provide for us. And he delights in his work. In the story, there's joy and delight. He creates something, at the end of the day, he goes, this is good, it's really good. Then he creates another day and he goes, it is good, it's good. Every day he says, it's good. Just like you do after a day's work, you're done and you go, it's good, it was good. Or maybe not. But the idea is that we have this sense, God has this sense of joy. And when God works, he actually gives us a clue on how we are to work. God brings order out of chaos. He creates, he's creative. So when we look at the creative world or the created world, you see the creativity, all the variations. Just go, my God, God is so amazingly creative and beauty. I mean, when we're in creation, you see the wonder, mountains, the ocean, valleys, all the things. God, in his work, it is always beautiful. And God's work is sustainable. Now, the creation sustains itself. And so when we work, we should work with sustainability, be creative, creating beauty, bringing order out of chaos. And God serves and he provides. And so that's part of what he does. And so God then, when he creates humanity, actually works with his hands. Then God says in Genesis 2, then the Lord God formed the man from the dust of the ground, and he breathed the breath of life into the man. And so in the creation story, it talks about how God, when he begins to create humanity, does it in a different way. And he actually works with his hands. And so it's right for you to think of yourself as a person who is handcrafted by God, who's designed in a unique way, formed by God, with all of your uniqueness and talents and abilities. And then the life of God, the breath of God is breathed into humanity. And so God is a worker. We see him working with his hands, ultimately in humanity. And then he never stops working. Look at what Jesus said. But Jesus replied, my Father is always working, and so am I. So God creates, but God didn't stop working there. He sustains creation. And the whole story of saving humanity is pictured in the Bible as God's strong right arm. So God works in a mighty way to save and to rescue his lost people. Jesus pictures himself as a worker in John 14. When he says, I'm going to leave, he goes, look, I'm going home and I'm going to prepare a place for you. And I'm going to design a heavenly home that's just for you. And when everything's ready, I'm going to come and get you. And so Jesus was working and is continuing to work. So we see that God is a worker. We're created in the image of God. And so we're designed to be workers. And the very first command that God gives us is to work. Look at what it says in Genesis 1, 26 and 28 and 29. Then God said, let us make human beings in our own image to be like us. They will reign over. And so there's our job, reigning over, ruling over the fish and the birds and the livestock and all the wild animals of the earth. And then God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply. What's the second command God gives us? Be fruitful and multiply. One of the very few commands that we've been faithful to follow. And then he says, fill the earth, govern it, reign over it. Then God said, look, I have given you every seed-bearing plant throughout the earth and all the fruit trees for your food. And so God's saying, reign over, govern it, watch over it. And then Genesis 2, he says these things. He says, then the Lord God placed the man in the Garden of Eden to tend and to watch over it. And so we're created in the image of God. God is a worker. Very first command God gives us is, I want you to tend, to watch over, to reign. I want you to manage creation. For what purpose? The same reason that God created it, to provide for people, to take care of people, to serve people. And then God says, I want you to be fruitful and multiply, to create community. And then the way that they're going to be taken care of is through the work that we do. So we provide and we serve in that way. So the first responsibility that's given to us by God is not to love God or to worship God, to serve God. Actually, the very first command is to partner with God in our work. He gives us a divine purpose in our work that we get to do. We get to partner with God in managing creation. So your work matters to God. And this is a gift that God gives us from God. And in the story of Genesis, you remember that it says in the cool of the evening that God would come down and he would talk with Adam and Eve every night. What do you think that he talked with them at sunset, at the cool of every day, at the end of every day? What would God speak to them about? He talked to them about their jobs. Their job was to manage, to tend, to take care of creation. And so God would talk to them about this partnership that we have. And so when you think about it, I just want you to think that all of the jobs, how many different occupations go into the managing of creation. So I'm going to just take one idea, the idea of just putting food on a table, and look how many different careers and jobs go into just managing creation so you get food on the table. So what happens is agricultural scientists study plants and try to increase the yield of plants. Hardworking farmers till the soil, use machines to grow crops. Then machinists design and build machines to harvest crops. Builders and developers build barns and houses for people, then are workers that can harvest the crops. Engineers harness energy from fuel and electricity to then run these machines. The transportation industry transports food. Retailers then sell food in the grocery store, and then you or your spouse or your roommate combine intuition and art, your knowledge of food chemistry, and you make wonderful meals. All of that, all of those careers, you think of science, technology, commerce, art, labor, transportation, do their part in carrying out the very first command of God, where he goes, you tend, you manage creation to serve and to provide for the people that I love. And that doesn't even include all of the other functions in society that protects and provides, like police, hospitals, governments, courts, educations, and municipalities. And so God values our work. And you know, as you read through the Bible, most people make it through Genesis, Exodus, get stopped in Leviticus, but Leviticus really shows us the heart of God. And so I read through Leviticus this week and I just listed all of the careers and the jobs that God cares about. And this is from Leviticus. God cares about buying and selling. He cares about manufacturing, interest rates, education, recreation, criminal justice, the disabled, the poor, the marginalized, family life, parenting, counseling. He cares about health, medicine, social work, childcare, homemaking, investment planning, water distribution, fair employment, public safety, land distribution, labor and building. God cares about the arts. I mean, God didn't make us so that we couldn't hear music and appreciate music. God didn't make us just see black and white. God cares about all beauty and art and color. And so God uses your work to meet the practical needs of people. And as you do that through your career, you're actually partnering with God and carrying out the very first command that God has given us. And when we understand that, it absolutely radically changes our attitude towards all work and all workers. I mean, when we understand that we are partnering with God in managing creation together, it changes our view towards all workers and all work. Now, we're going to read a passage in Ephesians 6. And before we read it, I want you to just help you, because when people start to read this, the first thing that happens is they get tripped up with the idea of slavery, because Paul uses it in this passage. And the first question people have is, Paul endorsing slavery? No, he's not endorsing it. The Bible never endorses mistreatment, abuse, or devaluing people of any kind. In fact, when historians write about slavery, and especially cultures where it was accepted, it is people who believed in the Bible that basically believed that slavery should stop. So the Bible does not endorse slavery. But in this passage, Paul's writing to people who are slaves. And so it's easy to say, you know, slavery, that's a bad job. That's a bad job description. And being working for somebody who's a slave master, you go, there's a bad boss. So as you read this, I think what has to strike us is the surprise in what God says to us out of that culture and that time. It's easy to understand the implication of what God's saying to us in this passage. And then what's really surprising is the very last thing that is said about God in this passage, because it is spectacular as it tells us about God's character. So here's what it says in Ephesians 6. Work with enthusiasm as though you are working for the Lord rather than for people. So just right there, we're working, we're to work with a heart. Remember, these are people who've got a bad job. Work for enthusiasm, because you're not just working for people. The boss that you have, this is a surprise, isn't just your boss. You've got a greater boss. Doesn't mean that you get to be cavalier, but you have a greater boss, which is God. Remember that the Lord will reward each one of us for the good that we do, whether we are slaves or free. Masters, now here's the shock. He's saying, masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Don't threaten them. Remember, now here's the line. Both of them have the same master in heaven, so that all of us are serving God. And here is the absolutely startling statement. The same master in heaven, and he, speaking of God, has no favorites. And so what's amazing in this passage is that he says, you know, look at, you know, some of these people, you know, if you have a good boss and you have a good job, it's probably not very hard for you. But if you're in a bad situation where you feel like I got a bad boss and, you know, my job isn't that good. I mean, what he says in this passage, these people had really bad jobs. And he's saying even that you are to work with enthusiasm, because you have to remember your ultimate boss, you've got a boss. And while that boss is important, you have even a bigger boss. And that is that you're working for God. So, you know, literally in your heart, say, I work for God. I mean, that's what this passage says. I work for God. And then he goes on and he says, so, and we can use employers and employees. He says to employers, he tells them, he says, you need to treat the people that work for you with honor and respect, because they are working for the same boss you're working for, which is God, and he has no favorites. Now, we live in a world of favorites. We see one job is more important than another job. And this passage doesn't say that there's anything wrong with someone being paid more for one kind of work and someone being paid less. But what it does say, that both workers, doesn't matter what work you do, all work is equally important and all workers are equally important. And the Bible goes, I mean, is constantly talking about how God doesn't play favorites. God isn't a racist. God doesn't value one race over another. He says in Christ, there is no Jew or Gentile, that God doesn't value social economic changes, that there's no, God loves both slave and free. And God isn't a sexist. He in Christ, there's no male or female. And so what God is saying in this, what he's communicating through his word, is there is dignity in all work, every work. All work has dignity, and every worker has dignity. They are equally important to God. Even though we don't see it, God sees it. And there is nothing that is more ugly and more sad than when we as Jesus followers treat some work as more valuable or treat some workers as more valuable, or worse, when we treat them with less dignity or value, or when I do it. And I've done it, we've all done it. And when I treat a worker with less value or dignity or work, it's usually in a situation where I'm in a hurry. And typically I'm working with someone who's in the service industry. And so I need something, or they're helping me, or I've ordered something. And because there's a long line or there's confusion or something happens, and I'm all of a sudden in a place where I feel like, you know, I'm not being, you know, I'm being taken for granted, or I get self-righteous. I just get selfish. I get self-centered. And when I devalue that worker, or I devalue their work, in that moment, what I am doing is I am dishonoring them. I'm dishonoring the work they're doing. I'm dishonoring God, who is the one that they're working for. And I'm dishonoring myself. And there is nothing, really, when we understand how God views work, there is nothing that's sadder than when we devalue someone's job, because every job is valued by God. It's a part of managing God's world, and every worker is valued by God. So look at what it says in Colossians 3:23. Work willingly at whatever you do, as though you were working for the Lord rather than for people. The master you are serving is Christ. I work for Jesus. I mean, every day you should go to your workplace saying, I work for Jesus. Not to be insubordinate, not to be cavalier, not to be better than. I'm not sure it plays well to go into your workplace and say, I work for Jesus. I'm not sure your boss would even understand that. But I think an attitude of wherever you show up saying, I work for Jesus, is the mentality that we need to have. What would it look like for you to show up at the place that you work with a heart that said, I'm here and I work for Jesus? What would change in you? What would change in the workplace? What would change in the people that you work with when you looked at them and said, your job has dignity. Your job, whatever it is as valuable as my job. You as a worker are as valuable as I am. My Heavenly Father doesn't play favorites. I'm not going to play favorites. What would it look like? What would change in the workplace if we just showed up that way? So then, why is work so hard? Why is it so challenging? Why is it so difficult if it's a gift from God? Well, ultimately, because when God created the world, everything was right. We lived in loving relationship with God and with each other, with ourselves and creation and work. But we didn't like it that way. We wanted to live our own way. And because of our selfishness, we damaged everything and we destroyed our relationship with God, but we destroyed our relationship with work and with each other. This is how it's recorded in Genesis 3. And so God says to the man, and to the man he said, the ground is cursed because of you, because of our selfishness and rebelling against God. All of your life, you will struggle to scratch a living from it. It will grow thorns and thistles for you, though you will eat its grains. And so he's saying in this passage, this idea that our relationship to work is cursed. And so it becomes more difficult. And that's why we grind at work, and it's painful at work. And that's why we compete with each other at work. It's destroyed our relationship with each other. And so we're broken in that way. And then we're broken because we try to get our sense of identity from work. I am what I do, which just destroys us. Or we try to get our sense of achievement. If I earn more, then I'm worth more. Or a workaholic, if I do enough, I am enough. And all of this is just destroying us. But God loved us too much to leave us that way. So God showed up in the person of Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago, and he saves us from our brokenness. He restores our relationship with our Heavenly Father through the cross, and so he forgives us. But also, he is restoring our relationship to work and to creation. We still live under the curse, and there's pain and sadness. But now God gives us his Holy Spirit, and in that, he gives us the ability to take joy in our work, to understand that work is a gift and we're partnering with God, that we can say it's good, that we can create beauty, we can bring chaos, bring order out of chaos, we can be creative, we can build sustainability and serve and provide for others just like God does, because God is basically redeeming us, saving us. And so we have the opportunity to partner with God in managing creation. So we have meaning in our work. The first way is we get to partner with God in creation. The second thing that we get in our jobs, and really Doug talked about this last week, is that we get to share God's love with the world. Look at what it says in 1 Peter 2:9. We are God's very own possession. And as a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. And so God has placed you in your job, your career, and you are an advertisement for God's wonderful kindness and love. He does this by giving you a new heart. He loves you, so you are loved. And so we move into the world with hearts full of love. We love God, and so we automatically love others, and so we're connected to people, and so we automatically move into the world wanting to love people. And then we have a new motivation. We have this sense of meaning and purpose in our work. And so we go into our work, and we get to show and tell about God's love. So just imagine all of the people that are in our church, all the people who watch online, all the people in all the different congregations, you think of how they're spread throughout literally the world. And they are in hospitals and in schools and in businesses and retail centers. And I mean, God spreads us all throughout the whole community. And we get to tell people about God's wonderful kindness and love, tell the story of how he saved us, rescue us. He meets our needs. He answers our prayers. We get to show God's love to the people in the world by what he does. And so we get to share God's love in the world by the work that we do. God sends us into the world as workers, and we're integrated with all of these people. The third thing we do is we get to share, experience and share God's generosity with the world. The way that God meets our need is he doesn't provide manna on the ground every day. He doesn't do it through the government. It's not by winning the lottery or you inheriting a lot of money, but the way that God provides for you is through work. Look at what it says in 2 Corinthians 9. And God will generously provide all that you need. Then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. As the scriptures say, they share freely and give generously to the poor. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. For God is the one who provides seed for the farmer and then bread to eat. And in the same way, he will provide and increase your resources and then produce a great harvest of generosity in you. And so God's saying in this, he gives you life and breath, and he gives you opportunities. He gives you a job, so you get to go to work. And when you work, it provides for your needs, for your family's needs. It provides for the needs of the poor, and it provides the need for all of God's work in the world. And so you have enough. Lots of people go, I don't. I just don't have enough. Well, if you say that you don't have enough, then there's one of three things that are true. One is God's a liar, so he's not giving you everything that you need, which is a dangerous thing to think. The second is you just have a selfishness problem. You spend too much money on yourself. Or third, you have a management problem. You're just managing what God has given you. But God has given everything that is needed to meet your need, to meet your family's needs, to meet the needs of the poor of our community, and to move the message of God forward, to multiply the message in our community. It's given all to God's people, and there's enough. Well, why does he do it this way? So we get to share with God. I mean, we get to participate in what God's doing in the world. Secondly, we get to experience generosity. I mean, God was rich, but he became poor so that we could become rich. We're literally acting out the drama of our salvation. When we give, I'm sacrificing, and so that others can have life. It helps me remind what God did for me. And then thirdly, people see our generosity, and ultimately when they see it, they're drawn to our generous God. And the last thing is we offer God's rest to the world. And this one is powerful, and is probably the hardest one for us to do in where we live, because it conflicts us so much. And it's this idea of offering God's rest to the world. Look at what it says in Hebrews 4:9-11. So there is a special rest still waiting for the people of God. For all who have entered into God's rest have rested from their labors, just as God did after creating the world. So let us do our best to enter that rest. The idea of rest in this passage is very clear, that we were lost and broken and our achieving and working couldn't do anything. We could not solve it. But ultimately, Jesus did all of the work. He came, died on the cross for our sins. Jesus worked so that we could have rest. And so Jesus is our Sabbath rest. And so that's the first cut and clearly what it says here. But it's also saying something deeper that's really important. And it's sort of around this question. Is it congruent for you as a worker to rest in Jesus, to say, I'm resting in Jesus, his love for me, and then be addicted to your job, be a workaholic, believe that it's what you do that gives you your sense of identity by working, you know, 7 days a week and harder. Is it congruent? Is that true? Because ultimately in the passage, what it says is that God worked 6 days and on the seventh day, he rested. And so how we work should integrate. I mean, really what this says is it transforms the worker and it transforms the work. It transforms the worker because you say, I'm resting in Jesus. So he's the one who provides. So I'm going to limit the hours that I work. And this is very hard with technology. I understand it. But saying I'm going to limit the hours that I work, I'm going to limit the days that I work just like God did. And it's all going to be a way for me to celebrate this idea that I'm resting in Jesus. And that's why for 2,000 years, Christians have had an idea of the Lord's Day, where literally there is a day where they would gather with God's people. They would celebrate that Jesus is our rest, that we rest in him. It's not what we do. It's not what we achieve, but that it is what Jesus has done. And so that we rest, but we gather with God's people. We study God's word. We're together with his church and we are resting in him. And so my question to you would be this, would the people in your life say that the way that you live your life, specifically your work life, would it reflect a person who is at rest? Would it reflect a person who's saying, I'm resting in Jesus and what he's done for me, that he is a provider, and they say, oh, I can see that in the way that you work? Or does the way that you work really reveal a sense of, I'm not enough, I've got to do more, I'm trying to earn it? Because this passage says, do everything you can to enter that rest, because it transforms the worker and it transforms the work, where we delight, that we get to partner with God and we get to rest in what God's doing. So you got to hear God's word. I mean, you wanted to hear from God's voice and God spoke to you today. And God's told you that your work matters, that it has huge meaning, that you get to partner with God. So what would it mean for you to follow Jesus and to live a life where you say, Jesus is my boss? What would change at your work and your mindset? What would be different? And what I want to do as we close is I just want to offer this opportunity for you to pray, and to pray a prayer that maybe you've never prayed before. But I want you to pray. So close your eyes and just pray with me and pray in your words this prayer. Say, Father, thank you for the gift of my job, for work, that I get to partner with you, that I get to provide for people that you love. I get to serve the people that you love. I get to bring order out of chaos. I get to create beauty and sustainability. Thank you for my work. And God, would you use me in my job to share your love with others, to show your generosity, and to offer your rest to the world. God, would you do that through me in my job? In Jesus' name, amen.
God of creation. vision there at the start before the beginning of time. With no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak,
and as you speak,
amount to your desire. You're the one who never leaves the one behind.
Every day, as you read the news, it seems like the world's going crazy. On airplanes, in restaurants, in places of business, people are angry everywhere. And the question that we just have to ask is, why are people so angry? And so, you know what? We need to know. And in our next series, Eric's going to show us not only why we're angry, but a better way and a solution to our anger. You're going to want to be a part of this. But even more than that, you want to invite your friends, because all of your friends are wondering, why are people so angry? And so God's word's going to show us, but it's going to give us great answers that attract us to God, make us love him, and give us answers that are a better way to live. So be a part of this next series, will you? Hold out your hands and receive God's blessing. Father, look at your children. They love you. Would you bless them and keep them? Would you cause your face to shine upon them and be gracious to them? Would you lift up the light of your countenance and give them peace? We ask in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in God's grace. You have a great day.